I want to introduce to you, probably, I have these friends whose minds and hearts and graces are so amazing that it's easy to get intimidated in their presence. And I don't think I've ever heard a theologian, prophet, amazing Italian crooner, ex-mafia wannabe, and ex-witchcraft devotee before he met Jesus. And I'm just, wherever Mark Chironna goes, he leaves his impact in the world. He's many of you might watch him on God TV or on TBN or different things. And we're so honored to have him here today. And we want to receive him as an apostle that God has sent to us. We want to receive him as a prophet who will speak the counsel of God to us. Would you stand and greet our friend, Dr. Mark Chironna?
Check, test, check. Yep. Okay, great. It's great to be here. You can't be unhappy when you get to this house. You just can't be. It's just like, it's infectious. Like, you know, and anytime I talk to Charles, even if I'm depressed, I'm smiling by the time the conversation is over. Now, he may get depressed just because of what I say, because Italians are worried about everything. And so we impart that very freely, just in our conversations. But it's great to be with Pastor Charles and Ann and with the team here and with you. I want to, you know, if I knew that when I walked into the atmosphere this morning, I was going to get a different word, I would have slept last night. I stayed up really late, worked really hard, and had a really great, great insight that I wanted to preach, and I don't get to preach it now. So I gotta just obey God. So just look with me at Luke 24. I really could have got sleep last night. It would have been great. You know, there's a lot of exciting things happening around here. You're in a really exciting season. I mean, you know, you sense that, right? Right. Okay. So you're in a really exciting season. So it doesn't take much prophetic insight to talk about that. But I want you to look at a really well-known story, and it may take me both this service and the next service to unpack all the things I'm sensing. But look at Luke 24, verse 13. That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself, everybody say Jesus himself.
Jesus himself.
So there's the superlative grammatically that's added. I mean, he could have just said, Dr. Luke could have just said Jesus, but he says Jesus himself. Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened here in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, It is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. Now, I don't want to get into the patriarchal thing that gets us in trouble, but it hasn't changed much. Ladies, God has liberated you, and the men need to wake up and realize that. And so it's almost like if it doesn't come from a man, it's not valid. But so, and by the way, this story, you know, Cleopas is named, and then there's an unnamed person traveling with him. And it was the literary style of the day, but you need to understand this is Mary, the wife of Cleopas. She is one of the three Marys that's at the cross. Now, here's the thing. How many of you know George Foreman has five sons named George? Okay. Well, this is Jesus' Uncle Cleo and Aunt Mary. Now, see, I'm convinced that the Marys were all Italian, and they just appeared to be Jewish, because in an Italian family, every woman is named Mary. It's you got Aunt Mary and your great Aunt Mary and your cousin Mary and her sister Mary. And this is Jesus' Uncle Cleo and Aunt Mary. And his name means famed of all. So what does that tell you about his ego? And she's unnamed. What does that tell you about what's it like to walk with a guy who thinks he's the most important person in the room and she doesn't even get recognized? So, I mean, it's just like, that's just free. That has nothing to do with what I'm going to say, but it's just free. So I want you to understand that this moment here is Jesus talking to flesh and blood relatives. This is Uncle Cleo and Aunt Mary. And so... Well, so when Cleopas says, moreover, some women of our company amazed us. And by the way, his wife is one of those women. She was there at the tomb. She was there at the cross. She's there at the tomb with Mary Magdalene and with Mary, the mother of Jesus. And it's a good thing only Mary Magdalene stayed afterwards, because when Jesus said Mary, he'd have had to respond to all three of them. That's all separate. I think about these things. Anyway, they were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said. I just find this funny. But him they did not see. And he said to them, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning themselves. Now, that word interpreted is actually better translated, he opened. He opened the scriptures. Keep that in mind. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, stay with us, for it is toward evening and the day is now far spent. So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at table with them, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened. And they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, on the way, the hodon, this pathway, this journey? Luke is trying to bring us into a place of not just looking at the physical realities, but the implications behind them. While he opened to us the scriptures, there's that word again, and they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, the Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. And as they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be unto you." I want to talk to you about Jesus sightings. Everybody say Jesus sightings. Now, let me just help us here, because we have the advantage when we read these portions of the gospel to have 2,000 years of church history and tradition behind us, but it kind of deceives us into thinking that we are past where these folk were on the night of the resurrection and the week of Easter week. We kind of think, well, we're past all this. We don't wrestle with these things anymore because we know Jesus is risen. And yet, I'm going to suggest to you that every time he shows up post-resurrection, he appears in a different form. He just has this habit of throwing them off. In the 40-day period post-resurrection and prior to ascension, have you ever wondered, you know, the fact that Jesus didn't ascend for 40 days and we only have 8 post-resurrection appearances, where did he go? Where did Jesus go? I think he went to New York, had some pizza, but, you know, I mean, he had fish here. He had to check out the Italians in New York. So, but be that as it may, he spent 40 days on the planet, and we only know of 8 appearances. It doesn't mean he didn't make others. And there are many instances in the stories in church history of Jesus sightings. Now, what if Jesus was seen in Harrisburg? What if God was saying to Life Center, there are about to be some multiplied Jesus sightings, not only in your midst, but in your region? Well, then we've got to figure out, do we prepare for that? Do we? Well, here's what I want us to understand. This is the human condition. We are very predictable and very comfortable in our predictability. We like same old, same old. We claim we like revelation. We claim we like radical newness. We claim we like breakthrough, but our behaviors indicate I want it to be the way it's been, because when I'm in the place of familiarity, I'm in control. And I'm going to suggest to you that when you're in control, you don't see him much. And what we call control, psychologists call a stuck state. And sociologists that work with leadership call it your comfort zone. Now, if you want to learn what you've never learned and see what you've never seen, you have to unlearn what you have learned and unsee what you've already seen. Because we carry within us deep mental models about how the world works, but those deep mental models are so deep we are not conscious of them when we are living in the moment, because they are governing us from the deep heart. However, because they are deeply embedded, you need to understand whatever is unconscious is in control. And so real transformation will never take place, and transformation by the Holy Spirit will never take place unless God can get you out of your comfort zone. And in order to do that, he has to touch the deeply embedded metaphors by which you see reality. Because you don't see the world in front of your eyes. You see the projection of the world you believe exists that's behind your eyes, that is projected out in front of you, so that the world in front of your eyes is not the world you're seeing. You are projecting your perception. It's based on the world that's inside you. Are you with me? So we don't see the world as it is. We see the world as we are. You with me? Have I lost you yet? Okay. And so have you ever heard the expression perception is reality? Well, that is a very reduced statement because it's way more than that. Because in order for there to be a perception, there first has to be an observation. You can't perceive what you don't see. So observation determines perception. However, prior to, let's say, so I walked in here this morning and I observed you worshiping. However, I've been here before. So even my observation of you this morning has a pre-observation where I've made previous interpretations of what I see. So even my observation today might not have been totally fresh because it would have been informed by my history and how I have seen and interpreted you based on what I've seen before. So even though I perceive you today, my perception is biased because it's rooted in prior observations and prior interpretations of what it's like to be at Life Center. So which means that I might not be seeing everything that's going on right now in this room because I'm only seeing what I am projecting based on my past history with you. You with me? I haven't lost you yet, right? So none of us comes to any present moment without a bias. We never come to any relationship, even for the first time, without a bias. Well, I never met them before. Yes, but you've met a lot of other people. And while you are interacting with that new person, you are sizing them up and comparing them to other people you've known. And you're trying to figure out their character. And you are, in your observations, making interpretations based on your previous encounters that then become your perceptions. But your perceptions aren't your reality because your perceptions then become your projections. And you project out onto that person what you have interpreted, observed, based on everything else that preceded that moment. But you're not even conscious of that because all of that happens in a split second. But if you're going to awake from sleep and rise from dead things, you'll have Jesus sightings. And you'll have Kairos moments. Because in Ephesians 5, Paul tells us, for this reason, it says, awake thou that sleepest and rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. And then he goes on to say, and redeem the time, for the days are evil. In other words, embrace the Kairos, because there are moments where eternity and time are so congruent with what wants to happen that there's a penetration that if you're not paying attention, you can miss your moment. And when those kairoi happen, you want to penetrate that moment and bring the future into the present so that it can shift every preceding interpretation of reality that has governed the unconscious belief systems that have kept you limited and prevented you from being enlarged. I lost you, didn't I? All right. So here's Uncle Cleo and Aunt Mary. Right? Everybody's got an Aunt Mary, at least in the Italian. I mean, you know, Aunt Mary, and Aunt Mary can cook. And Aunt Mary, if you don't eat three plates of what she cooks, she will say to you, you no lover me? I make all of this for you. You no lover Aunt Mary? I said, Aunt Mary, I ate three plates. She said, don't you know, there's kids around the world, they have nothing to eat.
And I said, send it to them. I've had plenty. I love you. I can only... I got a hiatal hernia by the time I was 13 years old, raised as an Italian in New York, because my Aunt Mary, my Aunt Tessie, my Auntie Dina, and my grandmas, it was all, don't you love me? Yeah, but I can only eat so much. But Aunt Mary and Uncle Cleo have history with Jesus. They've got history with Jesus. So they've got all these downloads that are deeply embedded about exactly who they have interpreted their nephew to be. In Italian, the word for nephew is nipote. This is their nipote. They know exactly who he is, they think. But Luke, the physician, is very precise. Because post the resurrection, there's been a Jesus sighting. And Simon has had an encounter with Jesus. And the women that were at the tomb saw angels and men dressed in white, and they claimed there was a Jesus sighting. And so Uncle Cleo and Aunt Mary don't know how to process that because it doesn't fit within their comfort zone. Because for a faithful Jew, resurrection doesn't happen till the end of the age. It doesn't happen in the middle of history for one person. It's a general resurrection at the end of the age. So all of a sudden, on a Friday afternoon, when Mary, the mother of Jesus, Mary Magdalene, and Mary, Jesus' aunt, are standing there, they're the only ones that are there, and John, everybody else flees, they stand there and endure the harsh, painful, ugly, evil violence done to their beloved nephew, son, rabbi, friend. And it is so deeply embedded. He is marred beyond recognition. And they have gone to bed traumatized by what they had to deal with. And so the imprint above all the other imprints of 30 years of knowing this little boy that grew up and they watched him grow up, they conversed with him, they talked with him, they understand how he thinks, etc., 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 now has on top of that this imprint of a Friday afternoon where they didn't even recognize their nephew, their son, their teacher. And they were participants in preparing him for burial. And the only reason they go back to the tomb is to finish their commitment to respect him honorably, to prepare finally his body for a decent burial. They weren't expecting resurrection. It wasn't in their model, deeply embedded, of how the world works. And Dr. Luke says that while they're making that 7-mile journey from Jerusalem back to Emmaus, guess what the word Emmaus means? Hot springs. There were hot springs in Emmaus. I have been to Banff Lake Louise. We lived in Calgary. Pastor Ruth and I lived in Calgary for 2.5 years of ministry in our first position in ministry, and we got to go to Banff Lake Louise many times. And you know, the average temperature, the reason we moved back in 2 years, because the average temperature from August to May was 40 below Celsius. So we really felt the Lord leading us back to lower latitude and longitude levels quickly. We learned everything God wanted. We did a condensed course of being a servant of Christ in Northwest Canada and really were persuaded God was leading us back to warmer climates. Had nothing to do with the will of God, everything to do with my body. I'm an Italian. And so here's this moment where they have to process that on this road from the pain and the suffering and the grief, their home is in a place where there are hot springs, sulfur springs that are very warm, that warm you from the outside when you're cold. The metaphoric name for Emmaus is earnest desire. And desire, metaphorically, is always related to fire. Because desire is tied to passion and motivation. As a matter of fact, when you read Paul in Galatians, when he says faith works by love, when you study from a psychological perspective the affective, affective side of the human internal mechanisms, desire is the fuel of what we know as love. So if there's no desire, there's no love, which means there's no motivation, which means faith cannot be energized, because faith works is energized by the core of desire. And desire in the heart can't be there unless there's fire. So they're cold and on the way to the hot springs, on their way to earnest desire. And yet, Luke, the physician, this precise, trained medical mind, makes a statement. He doesn't say Jesus approached. It says Jesus himself. The only problem is the imprint on their psyche is not a Jesus that's intact. It's a Jesus that was marred and scarred beyond recognition, that they wrapped in linen and laid in a tomb and were just intending to finish out of love what they started, that because the Sabbath was coming too quickly, they couldn't finish. So they wanted to go back and finish something that they didn't think was over because they didn't have closure. And the biggest question they had when they got up early that morning after the Sabbath, because they couldn't do anything on the Sabbath. There was no labor on the Sabbath. Matter of fact, on the Sabbath, you weren't allowed to light a fire. Remember when God says to Moses, make a tabernacle for me that I might dwell? And he says, I need you to, and I've anointed Aholiab and Bezalel as master craftsmen who are going to take metal and all these other things. And how many of you know if you're going to take metal and work it into furnishings, you need fire? And God makes it clear when he gives instructions from Exodus 25 to Exodus 40 that they need fire to do everything they're going to do to make the tabernacle. But he goes on to say, on the Sabbath, no fire. No fire on the Sabbath. So they have just gone through a fireless Sabbath, but the fire got put out on Passover because they saw their fire consumed as a whole burnt offering. But now they're on the road to earnest desire. They're on the road to the hot springs. And it says Jesus himself. And he gets in the middle of Uncle Cleo and Aunt Mary, and they're talking. And Jesus is the master therapist. And he's heard about these Jesus sightings. I wonder how he heard about them. And he says, what are you talking about? And they said, are you the only stranger? They don't even recognize him. Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem, doesn't know what happened, all the things that happened? He said, what things? Now, how many of you know he knows? But this is the wonderful counselor. This is the wonderful counselor. This is not the secular therapist that wants to bring you into self-fulfillment. This is the one who wants to save you from the inside out and take you on a journey of ongoing expansion until you become fully the person person he made you to be. And there's more than Jesus sightings, but the Jesus sightings are the beginning of the reigniting of the fire. And I just have a sense you are expanding this structure because there are going to be multiplied Jesus sightings in this region, and you're going to have to be like Jesus and meet people with preconceived ideas who feel their hopes have been shattered, and Christ in you is going to get in between them on their journey to earnest desire, and you're not going to tell them about Jesus. You're going to embody and incarnate him and ask them questions to bring out of them their incomplete interpretations, so that from there you can take them all the way to where they want to go. And so, you know, it says that the thoughts of the heart, Solomon says, are like a deep well. But a person of understanding draws them out. So here's Jesus. He's got a bucket and a string. You can't see it. It's called a question. What things? And he's putting the bucket down into the depths of their unconscious to pull up their metaphors. And he draws up out of what things all of a sudden comes up. Are you the one that haven't heard about Jesus of Nazareth, a prophet? Uncle Cleo, you know he said he was more than a prophet. Mighty indeed, raised up by God. Uncle Cleo, you do know he is the declared Son of God. You do know he's Messiah, a prophet. And we were hoping he was going to redeem Israel. So they have some sense of redemption, but they don't recognize him. And then you would think when he says, oh, foolish ones. I mean, do you know, my mother had phrases that were characteristically my mother. And I could be miles away and the phone would ring and the phrase would come and I'd say, I don't even need her to introduce herself. That phrase gives her away. Oh, foolish ones was very common from the lips of Jesus. But they didn't get it, because their projections onto reality were rooted in misinterpretations of what they were looking at, because they didn't see him as he was. They saw him as they perceived him to be. They were projecting onto him their own unfinished business. And so it says, oh, foolish ones and slow of heart. Desire flows from the heart. Fire flows from the heart. Expansion doesn't happen in the head. It happens in the heart. Your head's got to catch up to where your heart is. They're cold. They need to be thawed out. And beginning with Moses, he opens the scriptures. Now, can I tell you, until he opens the scriptures for you, the book is closed. I'm about to drop one on you. Just look at somebody and say, get ready. How many of you know Isaiah lived 700 years before Jesus? Right? Come on, wave your hand. Just wave your hand. Even if you don't know, just act like you know. Take my word for it. 700 years before. So how many of you know Isaiah's prophecies were known for 700 years before Jesus got there? What you may not know is that they didn't have a clue what Isaiah was saying, and neither did Isaiah. And until Jesus shows up in his hometown, post his testing in the wilderness, and the scroll of Isaiah is handed to him, and it said he opened the scroll, Isaiah was closed until the only one who can interpret the prophets, because he's the fulfillment of them, opens it. He is the interpretive principle whereby the prophets are understood. So it doesn't matter what they conjectured. Until he opens the book, it remains closed. And so here's the living Jesus opening the book. And while he's opening the book, he starts from Genesis chapter 1, and he goes all the way to Malachi,
about how Christ had to die and be buried and be raised on the third day. Now you're going to say, well, there's nothing in the Old Testament that says that. There are 46 Hebraisms and Hebrew idioms that refer to a third day principle from Genesis 1 all the way to Malachi. And liberal scholars would say this is not possible, but if you allow Jesus to open the book, he is hidden in 46 third day stories from Genesis to Malachi. And Jesus takes 7 miles to go all the way to the 46th reference from the scriptures, from the Septuagint and from the Hebrew prophets, the former prophets, and the Torah and the wisdom writings and the Psalms. And by the time he gets to, now he knows their house, he's been there before. But he acts like he's gonna go further. I wish he would have. Remember when Jesus said, I have many things to say to you, but you can't bear them now. And that's why we need the Holy Spirit, because he keeps leading us and guiding us into all truth. But watch, and I'm bringing this to a close now. He gets to where he knows they live, and he acts as if he's going further. But these are devout Jews who are committed to hospitality, and it's dark. The day has now come to an end. It's night. And so they need rest. And so they hospitably, according to Torah, invite him in to sit with them and rest for the evening. It's not just have a meal. It's you stay the night because you can't travel alone at night. It's not safe. And dinner is prepared. The only problem is that when he takes his seat at dinner, he no longer is the guest. He becomes the host. He doesn't wait for them to do anything. He, when he gets to the table, he takes charge. And he takes the bread and he lifts it up and he blesses it and he breaks it and he hands it to them, and their eyes are opened. Now watch, here's the process. He starts by opening the scriptures. Then he opens their minds. Then he opens their hearts, because it says, did not our hearts burn in us? But in order to get to their hearts, he had to open their minds, then open their hearts. And then when they recognized him, it was because their will was opened. Watch this, open scriptures, open mind, open heart, open will, open eyes. He restructures their cognitive processes so that they recognize him from the inside out. And once he is recognized, he vanishes from their sight, not from their presence. Because this is the resurrected Christ, and he is weaning them away from knowing him after the flesh. And the 8 appearances in preparation for the kingdom to come by the Spirit in its fullness is designed to expand them so that they would learn how to recognize him by the Spirit. For though we have known him after the flesh, we know him thus no longer. Now watch this. I'm bringing it home. Everybody say, open scriptures, open mind, open heart, open will, open eyes. See, you don't get here first. He's got to
undo. This is the very, very quintessential therapist. He's way better than Rogers, Maslow, May, Virginia Satir, better than any secular humanist psychologist. This is the wonderful counselor, because you can't be a wonderful counselor unless you know whose image you're made in. And the wonderful counselor goes back to Torah, the writings, and the prophets to show you your human condition, how you were built to bear the image and likeness of God. So he heals you by way of opening the scripture and then helping you locate your story in his story. And then he takes you in a process from opening the scripture to opening your mind, opening your heart, opening your will. And when your eyes are finally open, there is a recognizing, and you discover, did not our hearts, they got to earnest desire, they got to Emmaus. Took them all day to get there. And within less than an hour, the fire causes them to run back to the upper room. And when they get back to the upper room, the 11 men of paste and flour, I mean power and glory, have the doors locked for fear. Now there's been another Jesus sighting, and they're all wrestling. By the way, it's loud in the upper room, and you got your door locked, you're afraid of the Jews. Well, shut up. But there's so much commotion in the upper room, they're so stupid. Because they're talking so loud. They say, if you're afraid, why are you talking so loud? Because you're all in commotion. Because there's been Jesus sightings. So they want to believe it. And it says that Cleopas and Mary show up, and while they were telling the story, Jesus himself. Where did he come from? Where did he come from? While they were telling the story, Jesus himself. The first time, Dr. Luke says, Jesus himself is walking between them. This time he is coming from them. And when they open their mouth, they speak as it were the oracle of God. And he confirms by manifesting, this is me. Wow. Lift your hands to heaven. Father, I'm praying for Life Center, that there would be multiple Jesus sightings in this season. Burning hearts that have become ignited because the one they need to recognize in fresh ways by the Spirit, as they have passionately by fire, by the giftings and the passion and the great visionary leadership of the apostolic oversight of this house, they have been expanding this building because there's more Jesus sightings coming. And Father, I thank you, fresh fire is going to fall in this place from the inside out. And there are going to be fresh Jesus sightings in this city. And there's going to be fresh recognizing of him through men and women whose stories are such that he has repatterned them, got them out of their comfort zones, opened their hearts, minds, wills, and eyes, so that when they tell the story, Christ himself will manifest with many infallible proofs. Send that kind of fire from the inside out through this great house in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Give God a shout.
But now I want to honor my friend, Dr. Mark Chironna, who is, I think he may be the most brilliant friend I have, and I have a lot of brilliant friends. I have so many, I have friends, it's intimidating to be in their presence. They're so anointed, they're so smart, they're so powerful, they're so prophetic. They walk in the miraculous. They have impact around the world. And all of this is true of Bishop Mark Chironna, who's come to be with us today. He's been here before, but I think this is the first time on a Sunday morning. And I just say, fasten your seatbelts and open your heart and mind to hear a living word from God. Dr. Mark, would you come? Would you stand and honor the man of God?
Here, it's an honor to be with Charles and Ann and the team. I felt the anointing when I got here on Thursday because Thursday night, John took me to the Capitol Diner. Now you have to understand, as an Italian from New York, it was like homecoming. And so I made John and Rodney stay up late last night because I just needed a second touch. You know, Jesus had to touch one guy twice. I needed a second touch. And so when my wife and I, listen, back in the day when God was a teenager, you know, I proposed to my wife under the Verrazano Bridge back in when we lived in Brooklyn. But Friday nights was diner night, and over in Basking Ridge, that's New Jersey, by the edge of Bay Ridge in Brooklyn, there was a great diner, Italian diner. Now I can tell you every great eating place in America and every great place to get normal conservative Italian clothes. So if you would ever like to go on a tour with me to shop for clothes that make you look like you really are making a statement and eat at the same time, we're having a tour this year. It's going to be longer than a two-week tour, so save your money and join me for a six-month trip from New York to L.A., and we'll be just fine. But it's great to be here. This is a precious place. I love this house. I love the man and woman of God that's here. I always get kind of tender-hearted when I get here. It's just there's something precious about what's here. And you're in a season of expansion, naturally, and as well as in terms of enlargement in the kingdom. And so what I'd like to do today, I began to share something in the 9 a.m. worship experience that I'm going to continue. So I would encourage you to get the message from the first worship experience. I'm going to give you part two right now. I want to talk to you about Jesus sightings. Everybody say Jesus sightings. Jesus. So look with me at Luke's Gospel, chapter 24. And because we're in this, you know, God moves in cycles and seasons. And throughout church history for the last 2,000 years, there has been an ongoing celebration of the seasons of the church, and they are similar to the fact that under the Old Covenant, Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles were celebrated annually. The church historically has celebrated those things and yet celebrated them in their fulfillment in Christ. And so there is something called a liturgical calendar. And so we have just celebrated resurrection and first fruits in the last week. And so we are now in that season moving towards Pentecost. And God has a tendency to repeat himself. And I am persuaded that we need to lean into and live into God, do it again. And so it's not uncommon in resurrection seasons to go back and look at the stories that took place between the period of Jesus' resurrection and his ascension, which was a 40-day period of transition
to his ascension to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So whenever you look at the number 40 in the scripture, you are looking at a transitional period. Now, there's something to be said for the 21st century day in which we live, because we live in a day of rapid, unprecedented, accelerated change, which means transition is now permanent. We're having to keep up with everything that's going on, and technology is accelerating the rate of change and the rate of transition on the globe, and in the Western culture, it is having a major impact. By 2040, this is all free. This is all free. You're going to pay for the rest of it, but this is free. But in 2040, artificial intelligence will have so advanced that there will be artificial intelligence that also has biological components with it. This is the stuff of science fiction. And the church needs to start paying attention because of the next generation and things they're going to face as it relates to technology. I don't know why I'm saying this, but I feel like I need to say this. But our artificial intelligence, our grandkids, should the Lord tarry and they get raised up for ministry, are going to be confronted with, if I have to marry someone in a church, what do I do when they say they want to marry a robot? That's coming. That's coming. If the Lord tarries, that's coming. They have just performed their first head transplant on planet Earth. Shocking, isn't it? We are moving towards some things in the days that lie ahead where the rules are going to change radically in terms of how we understand what life is. Now, will Christ survive? Absolutely. But the question is, will the church be able to navigate its way into the future? And we don't have a choice. We have to understand the times and know what to do. And so I realize that the stuff that I'm saying may sound like science fiction, but I promise you that I'm not speaking, you know, like I got some dream last night. I'm talking to you about documented evidence of things that are being talked about within futurist societies and scientific circles and academia. This stuff is going on right now, along with all sorts of other stuff that is literally quite troubling. And yet I have an eschatology of victory. I believe God's going to have his way. I believe the Lord's going to do what the Lord's going to do, and he who began the work will complete it. But in this resurrection season, I want you to understand that when Jesus was planted in the earth, the quantum structure of the universe itself was altered. This is not just a religious act. Jesus initiated new creation, which is more than just you and I as unique persons getting saved. Jesus initiated new creation and began to reverse the curse of the fall when he was planted in the earth and descended into hell as victor over heaven, earth, hell, the grave, and death. So at a quantum physical level, everything shifted at resurrection. And in spite of how evil still endeavors to prevail, God's seed is bearing fruit. The embryo of resurrection and first fruits has been telescoping for 2,000 years, and God is recovering everything that was lost. And so what you need to understand about that is that as Brother Charles was sharing about, the seed contains information of the future. The seed is an embryo within which is a blueprint of the future. Okay? And that blueprint of the future is such that unless it gets planted, it cannot train the soil to bring the resources to flesh out what's in the seed. So the seed trains the soil. If I were to plant an apple seed in fertile soil, it would take 7 years to produce the hundredfold crop of apples I desire, because it takes that long for the seed, which has the blueprint of the future, to train the soil to bring everything necessary for apple trees to come forth. Now, if I plant an apple seed in soil and 3 years in, I'm not happy because I haven't gotten the fullness of my harvest, and I decide I'm going to change the seed and plant an orange seed, I'm now confusing the soil, and I will not only abort an apple harvest, the soil will have to be retrained for the necessary nutrients for orange soil, and I will even delay the orange harvest because the minerals required for the DNA of the powerful pull of the future of the orange cannot be assimilated because they've got to compete with the apple blueprint that came out of the seed and went into the soil. I'm going to read the text in a minute. And the wonderful thing about technology is that we have CDs and DVDs, and you can go, don't take notes with me because it won't work. Now, Brother Charles is brilliant, so he can, but I'm just promising you that you're going to take notes, you're going to get lost somewhere. And you're going to be trying to figure out what I said 3 sentences ago and say, I haven't got a clue where he's going. But here's the wonderful thing. I have this amazing anointing to be able to wrap it all up and put it together that at the end you're going to go, oh, I see it. So I promise you, you're going to get there. I'm actually talking about Jesus sightings. So what I want you to understand is that God the Father planted his son in hell. He harrowed hell 1985 years ago. When he descended into hell, he didn't go there to suffer. He already suffered at the cross. He went down to proclaim, I am now Lord of heaven and earth. Give me the keys. And he apprehended hell and plowed it wide open. The unrighteous dead, their fate was sealed. But everyone else that was in Abraham's bosom, he says, this train is bound for glory. Don't carry none but the righteous and the holy. And they got up with him on Sunday morning. Actually, they got up on Friday, but they had to let him go first, so they waited in their tombs. Matthew says they couldn't come out till Sunday, because until the God seed comes out, they gotta take his lead. So they need to know where they're going, because he's still saying, follow And so they follow him into the holy city. So there wasn't just one appearance of a Jesus sighting on that weekend. Can you imagine if you were the great, 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 great son of Abraham, grandson of Abraham, and he went and found out just over there by where he buried Sarah, and he came out from there and discovered he's got descendants that are part of him, and he knocks on the door and opens the door, and they say, who you be? He said, I'm your great, 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 I'm Abraham. And they fell down under the power, and he had a revival, and then he went to the next house. See, we got to trust the story. Because what Jesus did at a quantum level was reverse the curse of a fallen creation and initiate at a molecular atomic structure that resurrection life was going to begin to pulse through everything in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and even hell couldn't hold him back. So much so that when Mary and Mary Magdalene peered into the tomb on Sunday morning, there was a seat where the the body was laying, and an angel here and an angel there, eerily looking like the Ark of the Covenant, the cherubim between, with the mercy seat in between, and it was there, and John peered in. See, he didn't go in, he peered in. He was meditating. He was contemplating. Mary was meditating and contemplating because the eerie form of a throne was there, because God was leading a token that he's not just Lord of heaven and Lord of earth. He now has the keys of death, hell, and the grave. And since he left the grave, we can leave it too. A billion times a billion stars may sing, but we can leave every failure, because when he walked out of that tomb, you were destined to expand and enlarge, because nothing can stay dead in the presence of resurrection life. And for 40 days, in that transitional period, he presented himself alive by many infallible proofs. A.A. Allen used to begin every crusade with that verse from the book of Acts. He presented himself alive by many infallible proofs. And what he did in those 40 days established the archetypal pattern for us to say every time we celebrate resurrection, Lord, do it again. Lift your hands and say, Lord, do it again. We're ready for some Jesus sightings in this house, in this city, in this region, in this nation, and in the nations. Do it again, Lord. Come on, give him a shout. Give him a shout. Give him a shout. So here's the story, because I'm in the middle of Luke 24. And by the time you get to verse 33, Cleopas and the unnamed disciple have been on the road to Emmaus, and the unnamed disciple is his wife. Her name is Mary. This is Uncle Cleo and Aunt Mary. Well, whose Uncle Cleo is it? This is Jesus' Uncle Cleo and his Aunt Mary. So he appears first to Simon Peter. All we have is the testimony that he appeared to Peter. We don't have the record of his appearance to Peter. But it's interesting that he appears to Simon Peter. He appears to the one guy that denies him. When you get to 1 Corinthians 15 and you look at the specific people, when Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, by the way, 1 Corinthians is the first letter written of what we now know as the New Testament. It was written before the Gospel of Mark. It was written before the Gospel of Matthew. 1 Corinthians is the first letter written of all the canon of Scripture. Mark's gospel would be written a couple of years later, and this is about 20-some-odd years post the resurrection. And so the first mention of the gospel we have is in 1 Corinthians 15, when Paul says, I delivered to you that which I received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, was buried, on the third day he rose again according to the Scripture, right? Notice he says Christ died according to the Scripture, was buried, on the third day he rose again according to the Scripture, and appeared to Peter, to his half-brother James, and then he appears to 500, and then to as one untimely born, he appeared to me. Now just let me take an aside before I read this, because the first person Jesus appears to is a guy that denies him. The second person is his half-brother who doesn't believe in him at all. James was one of his opponents. You remember when Jesus is promulgated by his brothers and his sisters, go up to the feast? They don't believe in him. They've mocked him. They tell him he's crazy. Even James didn't believe in him. James the just, he was a Pharisee. He was like a Pharisee. He was respected by the Pharisees. He rejected his own brother. So Jesus' appearances were to Peter. Obviously, he appeared to Mary as well, but we're talking about, it's funny with the way Paul tells the story, because he wants us to understand the nature of why Jesus appeared to these three. He appears to Peter, who denies him, James, who doesn't believe in him, and Paul, who he says is a man untimely born, who persecuted him. And by the way, that word untimely born means he was an aborted fetus. Now that gives you a sense of how he sees himself. He was an aborted fetus. He's talking about that spiritually in terms of because of how he persecuted the church. So just think, just that would take a PhD to unpack all that from a scholarly perspective. But what do you do if you're Peter and you've denied him? And it takes Peter almost 40 days to sort through his pain. Because even afterwards, when he shows up at the lake of Gennesaret and Peter fishes all night and catches nothing, Peter still hasn't wanted to deal with Jesus. He wants to go back to fish because he's still not fully capable of handling. Because every time Jesus shows up in the 40 days, there are 8 recorded instances of Jesus appearing in Scripture in that 40 days. Now, he appeared more than that, but we only have a record of 8 of them. But each time he appears, they don't recognize him. There are stories of Jesus sightings, but they don't know him until after the fact. And what you and I need to understand is that the writers of these stories tell us these stories not so that you can come to the conclusion, oh, those poor people, if they only knew what we knew. They are designed to let you understand that you and I go through the same struggles, because often when you encounter the resurrected Christ by the Spirit, it takes you a while to discern, oh my goodness, I just had an encounter with Jesus. I'm saying that for a reason, because there are many Jesus sightings you and I miss. It's not always easy to recognize when Jesus shows up. So when Cleopas and Mary are on the road to Emmaus, this nephew of theirs, whom you'd think they would recognize, right? And if they looked at his beard, they would have seen, even in his resurrected body, the place where the beard was plucked on Friday. You'd have think they would have recognized him by the piercings in his hands or his feet, because they didn't disappear. He still got his wounds, doesn't he? So you'd think, I mean, they would have seen that, but their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. You ever wonder why their eyes were prevented from recognizing him? Well, Jesus says they were slow of heart to believe all that the Scriptures spoke about him. Slowness of heart will blind you to what's in front of your eyes. With the heart we believe, not with the head. Now, why is that important? Because psychologists, let me read the text. I'll back into the story, but let's look at verse 33. So they, Cleopas and Aunt Mary, this is Jesus' aunt and uncle, got up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem. They finally realized this is Jesus, and now they're going to go back to Jerusalem. It's a 7-mile journey, takes them all day, but then they run back in less than an hour. How many of you understand that once you recognize him, you mount up with wings like eagles? Things accelerated once you know it's Jesus, and he lifts you up to another dimension, and everything starts to move forward at a quicker pace. You're stuck until you recognize him, but once he puts all that back together from the inside out, you accelerate. Touch somebody and say, we're getting ready to accelerate. Say, this is a season of expansion that's going to be preceded and precipitated by Jesus sightings that cause our hearts to see what we've been missing and cause us to burn with a passion that's gonna move us at a level of acceleration into the next phase of our covenant history as a people of destiny for the glory of his namesake. Somebody give him a shout. And so it says that they got up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and those with them gathered together and saying, the Lord has really risen and has appeared to Simon. Oh, he had just appeared to them, but they didn't say them. They said to Simon. Then they told what happened on the road and how they recognized him when he broke the bread. They didn't recognize him in the pluckings of the beard. Oh, he was in his
resurrected body, but he still had the wounds. He's, you know, but they didn't recognize him. Their hearts were slow, right? But they recognized him in the breaking of the bread. And it says that once they recognized him in the breaking of the bread, he disappeared from their sight, not from their presence. There's a difference. He disappeared from their physical sight. Very important, because this is New Covenant now. Something has shifted. The resurrection has changed the molecular structure of creation itself. And so now he is no longer limited to be in one place at one time. He has vanished, not from their presence, but from their sight. I'm that bad a preacher, huh? I do that to people sometimes. And so they told what had happened on the road and how they recognized him when he broke the bread. And while they were saying these things, let me come down here. While they were saying these things, Jesus himself, everybody say Jesus himself. Stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." But they were startled and terrified, thinking they saw a ghost. Now, there you need to understand, this is Jesus himself. Jesus himself. This is the superlative grammatical. Dr. Luke is very particular. Physicians have a tendency to want to make sure you have all the details. All right? So when you go to a doctor to be diagnosed, they are going to reiterate certain things to reinforce your understanding. So this is the second time in Luke 24 where it says Jesus himself. The first time is when Cleopas and the unnamed disciple, which is Mary, his wife, are walking away from Jerusalem, discouraged, disheartened, disillusioned, and it says Jesus himself appeared. This is the superlative in the grammar. Jesus himself. Everybody say Jesus himself. So now here it is again, Jesus himself. Luke wants you to know, again, this is the same guy. This is the resurrected Son of God. Jesus himself appeared, and he said to them, and he said to them, "Peace be with you." But they were terrified and startled, thinking they saw a ghost. Look at somebody say, Jesus sightings will scare the bejesus out of you. Then he said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts?" Look, why are you frightened and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Where do doubts arise from? A heart. And he says to Cleopas and Mary a few hours before, "Oh, foolish and slow of heart to believe." Because the heart, according to the Bible, the heart is the place from which all the issues of life flow. Now, according to depth psychology, the heart is called the unconscious. And whatever is in the unconscious, whatever is in the heart, is beyond consciousness, but whatever is down there is in control. And there are things you do that you do automatically without thinking because they're so deeply embedded in you, you don't even think about it anymore. But many of the things you do from the heart at an unconscious level are rooted in less than reality, but you act on them as if they are true, and then it determines how you think, how you feel, and how you speak, even though what you're building your conviction on is less than true. And Jesus often will show up to restructure you from the inside out because your view of reality needs to be shifted, not out here, but in here. And until he does radical surgery on the inside of you, because he's the wonderful counselor, you will never see clearly out here. Remember the man that Jesus touched twice? I've heard so many sermons on, well, he couldn't do it the first time, so he's got to touch him two times because the anointing wasn't problem. That's not what he's talking about. When Jesus touched the man the first time, it says, "Do you see anything?" How many of you know this is Jesus? This is the great physician. Do I have a little extra time? All right. It's like 12:30. I just want to. So Jesus touches the man the first time, and he says, "Do you see anything?" Now, this is Jesus. You think he knows less than what's going on? So what does he say? The man says, I do see, what do you see? I see men as trees walking. Stay with me. I see men as trees walking. Okay, now if God wants to give you a biblical worldview, he has to go deep into the way he created your heart and restructure the symbols that you live by, because God created you to live by metaphor. At the core of your being, you don't think in words, you think in metaphors. And most of your language is metaphoric. So if your metaphors are off, your speech is off, and your perceptions are off. And so why would Jesus say, "Do you see anything?" It's because he wants to find out metaphorically how the guy is processing reality. So the first touch is a shift to bring him to understand biblically that human beings are called trees. Because they ascend to the, because they're a miniature, a tree is a miniature picture of the glory cloud that we get caught up into where the throne is. A tree is an image of the glory cloud. And so until you see human beings like trees planted, you won't see what human beings are, because they're rooted and founded in the Godhead as image and likeness bearers so that they can bear the glory in Christ. And so human beings reach to heaven and they literally allow him to be enthroned in their life. And so the first touch has to be a restructuring of the metaphors at an unconscious level and the mental models. And so once he's got his images clear, because we're made in his image and likeness, and so your imagination has to be sanctified, he touches him a second time and he sees everything clearly. Get the DVD. Everybody take a deep breath. Now, lift your hand and say, "Lord Jesus, do surgery on my deep heart. Shift my metaphors so I don't miss the Jesus sightings that are about to happen in this next season." But they were startled and terrified. They thought they saw a ghost, which means they've got preconceived ideas about what ghosts are. And we don't believe in ghosts, do we? But they did. I won't go there. Let's leave that one alone. Then he said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet." Now he shows them his wounds. Now he shows them his wounds. "It's me. Touch me and see. Put your," you know, we get mad at doubting Thomas, right? Because he says, "Unless I put my fingers in his hands." But he allowed them. Thank you, Ann. I'm glad you don't. I love you. This is free. This is another free one since I'm on a roll. Doubting Thomas is something we impose on the text. This is just a thought. I can't build a doctrine on this, but Thomas, Didymus, means twin. Means twin. How many of you know a pair of twins in life? How many of you know that when it comes to twins, one is named and the other one is called the twin? Come on. One of them is always named and the other is always referred to as the twin. So the disciples called him the twin, which means he never had his own identity. He was always measured by the other one, which would cause you to doubt anything, because until you know who you are, you won't know what you can see.
Right.
So Jesus has to let him have the experience, because he needs to be affirmed as a unique person and not be compared to the other one that looked just like him. Who am I apart from being the twin? Where did the doubts come from? His own heart. Because when you don't know who you are, you don't know where you're going. And you won't know who anybody else is, because you can't see yourself for who you are. Take a deep breath. Say, "Lord, do radical surgery on my deep heart so that I don't miss my next Jesus sighting." It's me, touch me and see. A ghost doesn't have flesh and bones like I do. Now, by the way, there's no blood here, is there? Because he's emptied it all out in order to remove the curse. But he's got flesh and bones. Now you got to ask yourself, if you got flesh and bones and the doors were locked and barred, how'd you get in here? Well, you ready for this? This is free again. How many of you have ever heard of string theory in quantum physics? In string theory, there are between 11 and 13 dimensions to reality. By the time you get to the sixth dimension, you can eat an orange from the inside out or walk through a wall without opening a door. So resurrection gives Jesus permission to transcend the limitations of creation and the order for fallen human beings, because he's already accessed the other dimensions of reality and now made a way for those realities to be released in creation in a way they never were before, because the fall affected creation itself. And the quantum physicist in heaven is saying, you ain't seen nothing yet, because the universe is expanding, and with every expanding thing, I'm going to expand my people so they fill it with my glory. Touch me and see. When he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet, and while they still could not believe it because of their joy. See, because there's something about Jesus sightings that just gets you excited. So now they've gone from, they go from 1 minute they're crying, they're scared spitless, and now they're just like joy, they're having joy fits. They're amazed. And he said, and so Jesus has a sense of humor. He says, let's press this a little further. Do you have anything to eat? I love this. Do you have anything to eat? I want to say, yeah, there's a Capital Diner in Harrisburg. And they got the best rice pudding I've had in 30 years, because I don't get it in Orlando. I don't care if they're Greek or Italian. It's all the same thing. They all argue alike. They all have the same dysfunction. Souvlaki is a lasagna just with another name. So they gave him a piece of broiled fish that they got at Whole Foods. And he took it and ate it in front of them. Now, here's what I want you to understand, and I want to do this as quickly as possible. They had deeply held mental models of how the world works, and they weren't expecting something called resurrection. Resurrection wasn't supposed to happen, according to the Jewish faith, until the end of the age, not in the middle of history. They knew everybody was going to get raised at the end of the age and the consummation of the ages, but for a man to die and come back from the grave and never go to the grave again, they had no category for that, no reference point for that. So when they encounter it, it is contrary to everything inside them that the metaphors they've been trained in have taught them to recognize. So they don't know how to recognize something that transcends the reality they believe is in their world, which means they can't control something, and now they are startled and shaken because they discover they are not managers of the universe. Our need for control prevents us from recognizing Jesus when he shows up. Look at somebody and say, resign from your position as manager of the universe. The job's already taken. How many of you know somebody in your life that needs to be in control of everything so that nothing goes wrong? My wife married one. I'm happy to let God help, but I'm in control. And so watch this. How does this work? Because in the story with Cleopas and Aunt Mary, first thing that happens, and the first thing that happens here, is that Jesus does it backwards in the second half, but it says that Jesus opened the scriptures. Everybody say, Jesus opened the scriptures. Now, beloved, you need to hear me. Until Christ opens the scriptures, the book is closed to you. He is the principle whereby all scripture is interpreted. In Isaiah 61, Isaiah prophesies, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he's anointed me to bring good news to the poor. In Luke chapter 4, Jesus comes back from the wilderness, has a campaign in Capernaum, moves in miracle signs and wonders, and as was his custom, he goes to his hometown and he is handed the scroll to teach, which means he's taught in his own hometown before. But this is now something different because now the declared Messiah who's come out of the wilderness, having overcome the enemy at every test, is now going to fulfill his mission, and now he alone has the authority to do what he's about to do, and he is going to open the scriptures. Every time he opened the text before, he couldn't open the text because he was not yet ready to be presented publicly. So now, when he gets into his hometown, as was his custom, it is handed him the scroll of Isaiah, and he opens up Isaiah 61, and he reads it, but it says he opened the scroll, which means until he opened that scroll, Isaiah and all the prophets were closed for all the years they had prophesied, because until he opens the book, you don't know what it's talking about. Christ has to open the book, and it's the same with you. You don't go to the book first. He comes to you. Haven't you ever read something in the book, and you thought you knew what it said, and then God takes you through something of a process? You know, and we hate the process, but he takes us through a process, and we go back and read the same text, and all of a sudden, the text reads differently because he opened you by opening the text. And when he opened you, you went back and looked and said, I never saw that before. That's because you didn't let him open it first, which means he's got to open you. Y'all breathing? Because he's doing surgery on your heart, because with the heart, we believe. So he opens the scriptures and he starts with Genesis and goes all the way to Malachi and goes through 46 references to Christ died according to the scripture, was buried, and rose again on the third day. Now, you won't find literal passages in the Old Testament on Christ died according to the scripture. What you will find is 46 allusions in Hebrew idioms hidden in stories about a death, burial, and resurrection. And where does it start? It starts in Genesis chapter 1 on the third day. When dry land rises out of chaos and darkness that contains seeds. Resurrection starts right there. And he starts with that verse, first third day verse, and goes from there all the way to Malachi. 46 references that liberal scholars say that's not true. I want to say he hasn't opened the book for you yet. You're just as blind as you, because they just don't know him. They just don't know him. It's 46 references. I'll come back and do a seminar on that one. We'll have a revival after every reference. And so he opens the scriptures, and as they're walking along, we know later their hearts start to burn. But as he opens the scriptures, what then opens up is that their minds start opening up. See, because the scripture opens the mind, but then it opens the heart. Then it opens the will. Everybody say mind, heart, will, and then it says their eyes were opened. See, you want your eyes open first. No, God's got to restructure the mind, the heart, and then the will where you make decisions. And then when you're ready to commit to do the will of God, your eyes will be opened. Because God's got to restructure you from the inside out and change the metaphor and do surgery because he's the wonderful counselor. Everybody say, open scriptures. Lead to open mind, lead to open heart, lead to open will, and then lo and behold, my eyes open, and I have a Jesus sighting. So now let me take you very briefly, because I could do this in a seminar, but I'm going to do it very quickly. Open scriptures lead to open mind. Guess what? Your mind isn't open until you suspend your judgments. Because there's a voice inside you called the voice of judgment. And it's the first thing Jesus has to deconstruct. Look at somebody and say, my biggest problem that I really believe is true is that I really am right. I'm not making judgments. I'm just right. So So when it comes to Jesus opening the scriptures, when he comes to your mind, he has to deconstruct your own internal voice of judgment that prevents you from seeing reality, because judgment causes you to split between good and evil from the wrong tree. So you're not eating at the tree of life, which is a place of wholeness. You're eating at the place that splits you between guilt and fear, because they've got fear, don't they? Which means there's guilt present, because the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is fear, and the root is guilt. Anytime there's fear present, there's a root of guilt somewhere, and Jesus has to deconstruct the voice of judgment because you've been eating at the tree that's killing you. So the next time you're wrestling with fear, say, what am I angry about that I feel guilty about? This is a thought. Just a thought. And then from there, I say, open heart. Open heart is the voice of cynicism. See, because if the voice of judgment is operating, guess what? In your heart, that means you're cynical. You don't think you're cynical. Look at somebody and say, I know I don't like to hear this. Come on, tell them. But if I really want Jesus sightings, I got to admit that there are places in my heart where a cynic is alive and well. And I need to know how to bring him to the grave or her to the grave and get past the graveyard of my own cynicism if I'm going to walk in resurrection life. Can I take a few more minutes? Okay, everybody say, open mind. I need him to deconstruct my tendency to be judgmental. Open heart. I need him to deconstruct my tendency to be cynical. Open will, because I got to make some decisions. I need him to deconstruct the voice that makes me afraid to take risks, because the voice of judgment in my head leads to the voice of cynicism in my heart. And leads to the voice of fear in my will that paralyzes me from taking the leap of faith. So my eyes remain blinded from recognizing what he's doing in the present moment. Almost. And so Jesus goes through this progressive dealing. Touch me and see. He's touching their minds. And then he's going all the way, and they still don't believe. And then he says, you got something to eat? And they give him broiled fish. And then once they recognize him, he commissions them and says, my spirit's about to clothe you with power from on high, and you will be my witnesses. Because once you have Jesus sightings that you recognize, you are now living witnesses. So that, now watch this, when Cleopas and Aunt Mary show up and they start telling their experience, it says Jesus himself came in the midst. He didn't have to walk through the wall. The 40-day period of transition was weaning them away from walking by sight so they could walk by faith. Listen carefully. So, where does Jesus go when Jesus vanishes from the sight of Cleopas and Mary? Where does he go? He goes inside. So the next time he shows up, he comes out of their declaration. Let him or her who speak as it were the oracle of God. The oracle of God is Christ himself. So as they're telling their own witness of the experience, their friends now have a Jesus sighting, and all glory breaks out. And now they need to know they can unlock the doors, unbar the gates, no fear, shalom, nothing missing, nothing broken, the absence of all things harmful, the presence of all things beneficial, because it's about to get exciting, it's about to get expansive, and he's about to pour out his spirit on all flesh. The ascended Christ is continually pouring out his spirit. I leave this with you, Life Center. Get ready for an abundance of Jesus sightings. And as you have them and let him heal you from the inside out, get ready for him to show up in this region every time you go out and start telling stories, because he is presenting himself alive by many infallible proofs.
Oh, wow. Jesus! Jesus! He's alive in us, yeah? All right. Hey, we're going to open this up for ministry very shortly, but I'd like you to sit down, and I want to give you opportunity. There's absolutely no pressure from me, but I want you open it up with your own response, and I want to give us all an opportunity to sow from our life into this word, plant seeds into it, so that it roots and brings forth fruit. And that's the purpose. And so we want to receive a joyful free will offering just to bless and honor Dr. Mark Chironna, even as we sow seed into the soil of this amazing word we've just heard. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's like, we want to do this. Like, come on. Do you want this to bear fruit in your own life? You can open it up by sowing seed. And we love to honor our friends anyway, you know. So, Jesus, are you ready? Do you need envelopes? If you need an envelope, wave. Just wave, you know. And if nobody sees you, stand up and just think you're in North Jersey and say, hey, you know, and they'll find you, you know. Oh, why didn't you say so, you know. So you give the following. You saw them on the board. Push pay, checks, all that stuff. Envelopes. Whoa! Okay, I want to give you a little time if you're doing the offering. There's always this balance, you know. You don't want to take too long because some people are waiting like, come on, come on. And other people are saying, wait, I can't write all the numbers yet. The big number or the credit card number, whichever it is. Okay. Jesus. We love you, and we love the man, the servant that who brought us this word. And so we give today with love, with joy, with a desire that fuels our faith, that faith might work by love, that this love offering would be a planting and a release of faith and apprehension in our own lives. Amen, amen. Okay, Ush, God bless you. Whoa, ushers, go ahead. So you can either get impatient, or we could just like let this soak in, you know, saturate. God, transform us. Do you want to be transformed? I'm like wrecked. I don't know about you. So you do a seminar on this. Great. Okay. Yeah. Jesus, 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 Jesus. I know some of you are still waiting to give. Are there ushers up there too? Yeah, great. Why don't you stand? Now, some are still giving, and some have given, and some weren't prepared, but God loves you. And could you just hold your hands before your heart, lift it to Him. Say, Holy Spirit, come, come again, keep coming. Break me open, deconstruct me, reconstruct me, release the manifestation of the promise in my life. I open my heart to Jesus sightings. May they come. At times I don't expect it. And at times I'm just sharing the testimony of Jesus. Would you release this power to save souls, to release harvest, to release healings all around me? In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You believe that? All right, I'd like the ministry team, if you'd quickly come up here. And I know some of you, you're just like waiting. You're in an encounter, but you feel like it's not fully birthed. What we have up here are midwives, okay? These are like just midwives. They're going to lay hands on you, and they're actually not going to do all the work. The Holy Spirit's going to do the work and release this in your life. You're invited to come forward. The rest of you, put your hands up. I want to bless you. May the Lord, the creator of the universe, bless you. May He keep you. May His presence, His face, shine in and out of your life. May He be gracious to you in every moment and every thought. May you know His countenance is turned toward you. He's ready to answer. May the peace, the shalom of God be upon your life as you carry His name and nature. And now, I'll repeat the words of Jesus. As the Father has sent me, I'm sending you. Go out and be the witnesses you're created to be. Amen? Amen.